Hey guys, it's Jeff Lafferty, and it's episode number 53, I think. Got something a little different for you today. I did an interview with a guy named Stephen Russell Black. He's got a Kickstarter running on Kickstarter. His project called Little Black Book, which is a collection of his art, and he's a really good artist. He's an independent artist, sells on eBay, posts around the web, and you know, he's kind of gained his own following, so I wanted to get him on here and just listen to what he had to say, because I think he's got a lot of good info for all of us trying to make it. Sorry about all the video going up late and everything yesterday. I don't know if I'm gonna get all my videos out this week. I'm like sick and everybody in the house is sick, and I'm thinking I need to take a day off. Actually, I did today, but hopefully I'll be feeling better maybe tomorrow or something. But the alien piece is actually just sitting here unfinished still. There it is. Close. I got a 4 or 5 commissions after that. I'm going to try to get some eBay stuff in there too, and I have a couple originals that need to go on eBay, so kind of a drag that all that stuff happened, but I don't know, I was thinking I'd maybe just start up the podcast again, you know, the Back to the Drawing Board podcast I was doing, but I made it, you know, I put all the stuff in there, the interview and everything, and I just kind of thought, you know, it's just like, that's the, I don't know, the old way I used to do things. Just didn't feel right anymore. So then I just decided to make a new one and put the interview just in my Artcast, and maybe we can do, you know, maybe get some more interviews. I think it's valuable talking to people and just getting, you know, their take on things and the way they're doing things, and you know, that's a lot of what podcasting is like that's kind of one of the reasons I had the podcast going at one time, is just to well, not only because I like to listen to them, but it's they're good to learn from, you know. A lot of the stuff that I do is just from, you know, random things people drop in podcasts and stuff. Let's see, what else? Last Saturday we did, or Sunday I guess, we did a Artcast chat with Peter Palmiotti, and a couple people jumped in there. Scott Selkirk and Kevin Cross and, oh man, I'm going to forget the last guy's name. His name was John, but should go check that show out maybe if you're into it. It's a lot more, I mean, my shows are scattered. Those shows are really scattered. And I think we actually went for like 2.5 hours. So if you want a gigantic, you know, monster show to listen to, you know, while you draw or something, that's kind of cool. And the, I put a playlist on my site, so you could just check it out here. You just go to my front page of YouTube and hit that playlist. There's, you know, there's 2 episodes in there. We're gonna be doing that every week. If you guys wanna come by and watch, and we're getting a little better at it, you know, about watching the chat room and stuff. There's still some stuff to learn though. Google Plus is a complicated thing, or Google Hangouts. It's actually not as easy to get one of those up and going and figuring out where the hell the chat room and everything is and inviting people. Then you know, it's just, I don't know, it's kind of like a learning process. But Peter's doing a lot of shows, Peter Palmiotti. He's doing another one called Studio Synergy. And he's the one who's hosting it every week. And I'm glad, because he's getting all the stuff worked out, and then the show runs a little bit more smoothly. But and if you want to be on the show too, you know, there's a link on the Artcasters board at the Artcasters Facebook group. You just go there, join, and all the info's in there somewhere. I don't know. It's fun. Hopefully I get some more videos up this week. I feel bad about missing videos, but I don't know. When I'm not even getting my stuff on eBay, I feel like a moron for making a video, you know? I should be, like, concentrating on my work rather than just other stuff, but I don't know. I would hate for this to break the streak, you know? At any rate, let's get going with the interview. I'm sure that everybody wants to hear that. I guess I'll probably jump back in at the very end, so you guys, and then I'll wrap it up. See ya. Okay, so here he is, Stephen Russell Black. Welcome to the show, Stephen.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, I appreciate you, you know, taking the time to come on. You've got a Kickstarter running called Little Black Book, and it's actually already funded. It's like $600 over already, and you got about 8 days to go or something.
Exactly.
That's awesome. Well, got some extra sounds there. Could you kind of give me a little overview of the project and tell everybody about it?
Sure. So for the last 3 years, I've just been doing a ton of drawings. Mm-hmm. And so I keep wanting to get to doing paintings and larger comic work and different things. But I was kind of stuck in this hamster wheel of doing the drawings because that was the cash that was coming in.
Yeah.
And so the book is trying to collect all of the drawings and things that I've done over the last 3 years to put that into a book form and then move past that drawing stage and start working on large scale paintings and bigger comic book projects that I want to work on.
That's awesome. Is this your first Kickstarter you've run?
This is my first Kickstarter. I actually had a little book that an art dealer ran for a Kickstarter for me, but this is the first time I've taken the reins and done it myself.
Okay, so you said an art dealer. Are you showing in galleries and stuff?
That's part of the thing. That's something that I want to move into. I wasn't. This was an art dealer that was more related to some of the comics work that I was doing, but I'm not through them anymore. So I just started working on with different galleries and things. I'm contacted by a few different people, and I'm doing a couple of group shows this year.
Okay. Is that kind of where you're trying to get to? Is like a fine art type situation, or
no? I mean, yes and no. So here's the yes and no. Is that I don't like to get pigeonholed into he's the comic guy, or oh, he's the illustration guy, or he does fine art. Like, I just like to do what I do, and then wherever it can fit into or I can flow into, that's where I'm happy. Yeah,
that makes sense. It's so easy to get pigeonholed, though. I think that people are always trying to do it, you know?
Totally.
How many, you said you were drawn for the last 3 years. I mean, were you planning the book for the whole 3 years? Or
No, I wasn't planning the book for the whole 3 years, but I just knew that. So that whole process started when I did this little series called 100 Souls, and it was just 100 eye drawings on the toned paper. Mm. And I sold them for super cheap, like on Etsy. I think they were like $20 a pop.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to get something out there, and I knew if I could get something in people's hands, then they would tell like 5 of their friends, and it would just go from there. And then after that came out, I started doing a drawing a day. And I lasted doing that for like 75 days in a row the first time. And then I was just kind of burnt out, and I couldn't make it. I was trying for a full year, but it never really made a full year. And I did it a few times after that to like 30 in a row, 40 in a row. But and so that was part of that last 3 years.
Wow. Those eye drawings, how big were those eye drawings?
Tiny. They're like 5.5 by 5.5.
5.5, yeah. How big are the drawings you're doing kind of now, like the ones I've seen on like Facebook, like the vampire one and stuff?
Oh, yeah. Most of those are all 11 by 17.
11 by 17, okay. So not super big still, but...
Exactly.
What medium are they?
It's all this toned paper, and then Credicolor Nero pencils, and then mostly Prismacolor, just black and white.
Yeah, okay,
and cool. Then I'll kind of switch it up. I'll grab different colors of toned paper, like some reds and browns and things, and so I have a little leeway, but it's still all value-based. It doesn't rely on the color very much at all.
Yeah, it's a great look, and really super creative. I mean, where do you come up with all those ideas. I mean, they just seem crazy all over the place.
Just my perspective, just my point of view, I guess. Yeah.
That's it.
I think so. I mean, there's you do kind of two things, right? There's all of your influences and the stuff that you like, mm-hmm. and then there's all the stuff that you take in on a daily basis, like trips to the museum or being out in nature and you know, you see a leaf and it's a certain color and that color reminds you of something else and it snowballs into an idea, but the idea didn't, you can't pick one place that it came from. It's a collection of these thoughts and memories and visions and images that you see and you experience on a daily basis. So that's the toughest question. We go, where do you get your ideas? And I'm like, well, everywhere, nowhere. It's
right. Do you do a lot of sketching or working in the sketchbook to come up with them, or are they just pretty much grab a piece of paper and go to town?
I grab a piece of paper and go to. I actually do both ways. So the daily drawings and the things that are mostly on Facebook are stuff that I'll just grab a piece of paper and I might have a couple of pieces of reference or not, and I'll just start drawing and make stuff up, and it kind of is like an improv from there. Mm-hmm. But then other times some of those pieces are for commissions, and those definitely have a sketch process behind them. And I actually have two sketchbooks. I have a little square-bound book that I show people that's just beautiful drawings or drawings that I'm trying to make beautiful, and that's what I'll show people. But I also have a little 4x6 sketchbook that's just for me, that's like I call coal mining. I'm just digging around looking for, and it's just, they're horrible drawings. they're just sketch after sketch after sketch, like digging and trying to find something interesting.
Yeah.
And then you pull up that one idea and go take it to the board and render out, you know, the stuff that you were digging around in. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah, I have something similar to that. I have like an ugly sketchbook I don't show anybody, and then
yeah. But you need that because that's where the good stuff comes from.
Absolutely, you got to be like kind of, you know, free to draw bad. At some point, you can't figure out anything.
No, totally. When I get overwhelmed, I go draw with crayons.
Yeah, I saw some of that crayon stuff on your Facebook page. That was they still look awesome. So
thanks.
Yeah, it is. It's really beautiful work. I don't mean to just gush, but when I saw it, I was just blown away.
Oh, thank you.
What about, like, I guess let me talk a little bit about your background and stuff. I mean, how old are you, if you don't mind me asking?
35 this year.
35, okay. How'd you learn how to draw and paint?
I guess like everybody draws when you're a kid. I just never stopped. I was really lucky. I had a high school art teacher who was actually a college professor and thought that if he dropped down to high school, he'd have more time to paint for himself. But he was actually teaching us like these college level things, and I was figure drawing when I was a freshman. Mm-hmm. And he actually bumped me into the senior class and let me go take figure drawing and stuff for my high school credits and things.
Oh, interesting. They actually had figure drawing at your high school?
No, but he was connected to the local college, and so he got me into the college figure drawing classes when I was a freshman.
Oh, wow. That's awesome. Yeah. Did you end up going to college then after that?
I did. I went to Columbus College of Art and Design back in Ohio.
Yeah. Did you finish and everything?
I did. Yeah, bachelor's of fine art with a major in illustration.
Okay.
And I had some incredible professors there. C.F. Payne, John Drew Palancar.
Oh, wow.
Joe Kovash, and Palancar and I are like really hit it off, and even after school we're friends, and I have a couple of original Palancars, and
wow,
yeah, I love that guy. So he's a huge influence, definitely.
Who else are your influences, actually?
Growing up, it's like comic book stuff, because I grew up in the middle of nowhere, so the only like art, like quote unquote art kind of stuff was Dali books in the museum, or uh-huh. In the library, and going to the local corner store and buying comic books.
Oh, buying comic books from the corner store?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that makes sense. What about later on, did you, you know, or even now, are you influenced by anybody? I mean, your stuff seems really original.
There's a couple people that I really love, but I try not to emulate anything that they do. But Palancar, and then he turned me on to a guy, Gottfried Helmlein.
Yeah. I don't know him, actually, but yeah.
Yeah, a fine art painter. Does these giant, beautiful paintings, mostly of children, and the horrors of war and things like that. But I got to meet him at the Modern Eden Gallery here, and in the city, and he's fantastic.
Do you, so are you making your living as a as an artist right now, or are you doing this on the side?
There's side stuff. I mean, I cobble together a living from various like sources, but I have a day job with a printer a few days a week, and just the illustration stuff, and selling original art.
Selling original art, yeah.
Yeah.
I listened to your interview with Moorbacher, and yeah, so I kind of got a little bit of a gist of, about what you're doing. I noticed you mentioned selling your stuff on eBay and stuff. I sell a lot of art on eBay too. I mean, could you tell me a little bit about your experience on there?
Yeah, I don't do it anymore.
Don't.
that's my experience with it. Is that it? I feel like it drives the prices down. I don't know. There are different waves, and I know that some people can use it to their advantage to drive prices up. And there's a recent trend with like the original Magic card art that are just, the prices are going like crazy because there's a huge demand for that right now.
Yeah.
But I really liked the idea of setting the price at like 99 cents and throwing it up there and just seeing how high it could go.
Oh, wow, yeah.
And that was, sometimes you're surprised by that and you're happy with the price, and sometimes it's a tragedy and you're like, oh my God, how could that possibly go for so low? And so it's a roller coaster up and down, and I knew that going in, and that was part of the strategy to just to get my name all over and the work all over and to try to sell. And again, like I knew if I could get, even if somebody bought it for like sort of low, I didn't care because it would get in their hands, and then they would be my biggest supporter and tell five of their friends. So it was a strategy, and it worked. And I think the people who got those pieces at those low prices and have bought for me in the afterwards are happy they got them and they got to buy in at that low time. But I won't sell on eBay anymore.
Right. Is it just because of the low prices? I mean, have you tried putting stuff up for higher on there, or for higher prices? I mean.
Yeah, but I don't. There's all this pricing thing where eBay takes cash from you and then PayPal takes cash from you, and they're the same company, so they're taking cash from you twice. And right. I don't know.
It's not the best situation, that's for sure.
No, but if there's nothing else, it does give the reins of that kind of stuff to someone to put things up there and to get selling quickly.
Did any of the people that bought from you when you were on eBay, did they stick with you as customers? You
still definitely. Sell?
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I think that definitely built a, and so you know you cobble together fans, friends, and followers like from all different social media, and there's definitely some people that only found my work on eBay and then followed up and you know sent me an email or connected with me on Facebook or some other site and. Are still collectors of the work, so it works. You know, you just got to put your stuff. You got to spread your net as far as you can, and, to connect to the people who would be excited about your work.
Yeah, I noticed that when you were talking to Moorbacher, you kind of mentioned you know like strategic posting or something like that.
yeah, no, definitely. I don't remember who I heard that from, but that's what I was doing when I was doing the daily drawings. Is that there's certain times on Facebook. I was playing the game. There's certain times on Facebook that more people are on or off or these sort of things, and so you want to put the work in the up when people are going to switch. So it was something like I don't do it anymore, but it was something like 8, noon, and 4:30 are like the boom times on Facebook or any social media. Mm-hmm. So when I was doing those daily drawings, in the morning I would start it and I would take a photo and I would post it up like you know start today number 27, and then around lunchtime I would start working on it again and get a little farther and be like almost done, like just to put another post up during the time that everyone would see it, and then around that 4:30 time I would finish and post it to eBay and yeah. So no, it was very calculated, strategic thing on trying to get as many people as I could to see it.
Yeah. No, I think that works. I actually do kind of the same thing. I always put my stuff up about 3:30. Just because it's like everybody's on Facebook, it seems like, you know,
yeah.
In one way or the other, or they're going to be there in a little while.
Okay.
What about other places? I mean, that was one thing that did catch my, you know, attention. Also, you said you didn't have a website.
Yeah.
I've seen other guys on eBay make that work with no website. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, I think it's nice and it's professional. I should have one probably, because it's just like your parking page for a portfolio or for things. But I think I heard like Aaron Miller say like if everybody's on like why try to drag somebody to a different place when just put the work in front where everyone's at. And so to try to get to everyone to go to my website to sell things or to look at things is, I don't know how much traffic that would get.
Mm-hmm. Well, just on my own website, I know that, you know, that's the least amount of, you know, traffic I get anywhere. But yeah. Also, do you ever worry about people losing track of you with, like, no place to kind of sign up for, like, an email list? Or do you even have an email list?
No, I don't. I should do that. I guess off of my blog, there's, like, a little section where people can sign up. And I haven't been really great about keeping up with the blog, but I do want to do that in the future because I think that those can be more meaningful, like, longer posts about more detailed things than just putting up an image and a little bit of text. So I do. I think those are more meaningful, exciting posts when people put longer posts on a blog and think things out. And maybe it's a very almost like an article-based kind of thing. Like, it's a whole thought around a...
Right. So. Well, you know, another big thing, like, why I like my website, or, you know, I feel like maybe you need one, or not you, but you know what I mean, is, like, the store aspect of it. Do you have a store somewhere?
I use Etsy for like prints and things like that for the smaller.
That makes sense. Do you have good luck on Etsy?
I do, but I think a lot of people going into it, eBay too. A lot of people go into it thinking like, oh, I'll just throw some stuff up there and then it'll sell. And it's like, it's kind of the infrastructure to be able to sell something, but it's not going to find a lot of new people for you. You kind of have to go into any of those things with the audience already built in. It just kind of offers you a place to be able to sell to them.
Mm-hmm. Did you mention prints? Do you do prints of your drawings also?
Just recently, and I don't know why. I thought there was like a barrier between like doing the prints. I thought they were so much, but like cost wise to jump into that.
Mm-hmm.
And I've found like several different printers and people that I'm happy with working with, and I'm just like, oh wow, like. I totally have access to this. Like, it's not this huge thing I thought it was. So I have been dipping a toe in with like postcards and things, and I'm working on prints for this Kickstarter as rewards as well.
Yeah, I did see that. Excuse me, that you had a couple levels where the prints and pretty reasonable too. I think it was two prints for $20 or something.
Yeah, and they're small prints and I'm kind of basing that off of like what some other people are doing in that same area and size of print.
Yeah. What about conventions and stuff? Do you sell at conventions also or no?
I don't really do conventions and that's something that another thing that I really wanted to do and I didn't feel like I should jump into any of that stuff until I had sort of built a following of people and maybe that's doesn't matter. I could have just done it anyway, but I haven't until this year, so I'll be doing a couple this year, and then trying to do as many as I can next year because I think they're really fun. I love going to conventions and seeing people, so that's definitely something I'll do next year a lot. And this year, I'm doing a few.
Yeah, I was just looking through your Kickstarter. I mean, $35 gets the book, $100 gets an original drawing. Is that like is that pretty consistent with what your prices are for your commissions, or is that quite a bit lower?
No, it's probably a little lower. It's probably a little lower.
Is that working for you, though, getting the original drawings as a pledge?
I think it works for me on this one.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I'll offer that again as a reward, and definitely not at that price, because prices have been going up.
Well, that's great. That's the way they're supposed to go, right?
Right. You hope.
Yeah, and then I noticed too, just to kind of caught my eye, like everything's going to be shipped by September.
Yeah,
on your Kickstarter, that's awesome.
Totally, I know he was surprised by that as well, and he was like, you know, you really don't have to be that fast at the shipping the stuff out, and I don't see why not. I think they should go out fast since I don't have to wait on the printer that long and. I don't know. They're pretty fast, so
mm-hmm.
I feel like I'll get the stuff back pretty quickly, and I just want to get it to people as quickly as possible. I'm just super overwhelmed by how many people turned out for the Kickstarter and backed it so quickly, and I don't know. I feel like that's important to get it to them fast.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, at least you're a guy who's already selling stuff. You're probably used to shipping stuff. you know, not just coming in and it's like you see a lot of people and they don't even understand like that it's going to cost something to ship stuff. So I'd imagine you're probably going to be pretty good at it.
Yeah, that was the initially a Kickstarter problem, right? Is that people didn't calculate the costs, and so they were making very little on their Kickstarter, or they were saying it wasn't worth it or fail because they hadn't calculated shipping costs and things. And I know that was a problem early on, or people not even shipping things at all.
Yeah, that whole thing. Where are you getting your book printed, actually?
I'm looking. So I have this place in mind that does paperback books that I really like. I've worked with before, but I'm also shopping around to three different other places that can possibly do it as a hardbound book.
Yeah. Go ahead. Is it going to be hardbound, actually?
Well, the Kickstarter actually ran as a paperback book, and that's what's going to happen for sure. Uh-huh. But I'm poking around now to try to upgrade to the hardcover if I can.
Have you thought about that, like as a stretch goal or something?
I would think definitely. And I was thinking around 8,000. If I can hit 8,000, we'll definitely do the hardcover.
That's cool. You might do it. I mean, you still got a ways to go here. What about once the thing's printed? I mean, is it going to be available in, you know, from other places like Amazon and stuff, or is it pretty much just a Kickstarter only deal?
It's a Kickstarter for now, and then I'll actually have over. What I learned from Michael C. Hayes is that you do this, and it generates, you know, people who back you get the book, and they're excited. But what it actually builds is a back inventory of prints and books and things, because you when you go in to print them, you're printing over, or you're printing at numbers to make it cost effective for you. But so I'll have quite a bit over, and which is fantastic, because I'm going into a couple different shows in August and September, and then one in October, where I'll have this inventory of stuff to be able to sell those shows, but I'll also make it available either on Etsy or like a direct sale through Facebook or something.
Right. Yeah, that's a good idea, definitely, to overprint and have some stuff to make some more money past this. And then I also noticed, just kind of back to like your art and stuff. I mean, it might be in your video, but you're talking about kind of trying to get into doing paintings now and kind of going away from the drawings. Is that what your plans are?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I always do like a preliminary sketch for the painting anyway.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, large scale paintings is what I want to move when I want to move into. Kind of two things. Like I said, I don't like to get pigeonholed. Large-scale paintings to pursue more gallery stuff, and just I love that as an art object. I think that's like the most elaborate thing you can do is this fully painted large-scale painting.
Absolutely, yeah.
And then the other part of it is a lot of my most of my images are idea-based. Like I'm telling a story or a little snippet of something, and so the other thing I want to do is get to expand on that story. So I'll be doing more long-form comic stuff so that I can not only like have that one moment in the story where I showed you like that thing, but trying to tell like more of the whole story behind the character.
Mm. So you're into comics too then, huh?
Definitely.
Yeah. Have you worked in comics at all?
My love-hate thing with comics, because and it's my own fault, actually, I found, is that someone will present something and I'll say yes just because I want to work on like a comic, and then I'll get into it and it's like I don't want to draw this, or this is not the thing that I want to do, or when it does go well and it's subject matter I'm excited about, the company failed or fell through. I actually got, I don't want to say the name, but I got a small company. I did four covers. I finished a first issue. I turned everything in. And they hadn't paid me for a month and a half, and they actually called them to be like, you know, where's my check? And they're like, oh, the check's in the mail. Literally, the check's in the mail. And so I was like, I'm done.
Wow.
I'm done with you guys. So, I don't know. Like, I love comics, but I think I'll do it myself so that I can control every aspect of it a little bit more than,
yeah,
than the experience I've had.
Comics is a super tough business, I think. For a lot of, you know, a lot of that kind of stuff. I mean, it's a ton of work just to get to the point where you can sell something, and then, you know, just the companies that are there. It's the kind of work that's available. It's tough to get high paying work in comics.
Yeah, it can be. I'm talking with a couple of higher profile writers right now to see if we can collaborate and do something cool.
Wow.
One project's moving forward, and another we're still talking, but We'll see. I think a lot of that stuff, the product's always better when you you're doing it yourself. I know definitely from experience when I do a drawing commission or something and I post that, it gets like a few likes. But when I do my more personal work that was more meaningful to me and I post that, then it, you know, gets a ton of likes or shares or stuff. And it's not that those things are of the utmost importance, but they're just kind of like validators or benchmarks to say, oh, okay, like people like the work. And it's always been my experience that the personal work is way more popular, which is great for me because I would rather do that stuff.
Yeah, you're obviously like kind of approaching it like, you know, independent artist, and it's working for you. So, you know, that's, you know, more validation right there. Okay, well, I guess that's it. Thanks for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. I'm glad that your Kickstarter's funded, and that's awesome. So, thanks so much for coming on.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, and we still have 8 days. So anybody who wants to grab a book now, and especially on those backer levels where they can grab a drawing or something at the lower price, like this is the time to grab it.
Absolutely, it's a steal. $100 for one of those things. That's awesome. I'm thinking about it myself. do you have any other websites you'd like to mention where people can catch up with you?
I don't. And if you Google my name, I'm all over all the social media, and I like to do that because everybody has their own favorite, you know, like one that they like to hang out more than somewhere else. And if you just Google my name, I'm all over.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot, Stephen. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hey, guys. So that's it. There's the first interview on my show. I wish I would have kind of tried to shoot it as a video interview. I don't know if my software that I got that records stuff over Skype can hack a video interview. Maybe I should do a test of that before I get somebody important on here. It works, and I don't know, it's a little different than what I usually do, so I appreciate Stephen for coming on the show. Check out his Kickstarter, you know, if you want to pledge, go pledge. I know he'd appreciate it. He had some good stuff in there, and I think too, like, it just, you know, just once again, it just shows, you know, if you put stuff out and you build an audience, then you have an audience to that buys your stuff and supports you, and it works, you know. And a lot of the minutia of like how to do that really depends on people showing up, you know, to buy your stuff or whatever. There's other benefits to having like an audience or whatever you want to call it. I don't know. I mean, just like the Artcasters thing has grown, the Facebook group has grown, there's like all these people now circling around this thing, and I'm really interested to see kind of where it goes, because I don't think that there's been much of a place in a way to, I'm talking about the Facebook group right now, but also just everybody watching these videos and stuff that are chiming in. And just the videos in a way, because it's like, I just don't think there was any kind of voice for, like, us in a way before I guess I started blabbering in a way. I don't think that anybody really was just kind of talking about being an independent artist, you know what I mean? It's a real thing. It's like a real possibility to, like, make like money, and a lot of money, and I think that in the future it's going to become like a career path. People are going to like figure out what they want to do, and some of them are going to be like, I don't want to work for anybody, I'm going to work for myself, and I'm going to make my own way, like a lot of guys in webcomics, or guys that, you know, do... Well, I don't know. I mean, webcomics is the big one that I've kind of seen so far. I guess some of the indie book guys on Amazon and stuff. Where was it going? I kind of forgot what I was talking about. I told you I'm like sick, so I'm kind of out of it today. But anyway, I appreciate Stephen coming on the show. And I'll see you guys, man, I don't know, tomorrow. Maybe I'll just try to shoot a show real quick and get it up tomorrow so I don't miss one. See you guys.